Good morning and happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters. God is truly wonderful and amazing as we have the technology to hold a Sabbath service. Let us continue to pray for our leaders and frontliners that God may enlighten and guide them during this time. Soon this pandemic will end and we can be together physically. The Ilocano Sabbath School Group is delighted to be a part of today's service. On behalf of the Ilocano Ministry, I would like to welcome everybody. May the blessings of the Lord be upon us. Have a blessed and great Sabbath to everyone.
I'm inviting you to open your hearts and minds as we listen to our call to worship, which is found in Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anointed my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the rest of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May the Lord add his blessings to the reading of his words.
Perfect delight, visions of rapture. Our scripture reading for the Sabbath day is found in the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 23. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful.
Let's bow our head for a word of prayer. Our most graciously and loving Father in heaven, we want to thank you for the privilege of worshiping you even amidst of this pandemic. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings you bestowed to each one of us throughout the week. And we want to thank you for your protection for this virus spreading around us. Lord, we want to give our fears and worries unto you. We want the peace that the world cannot give unto us. And we know that we are now living in the days of trials, a day of probation,
a day of testing our faithfulness. May you help us then, Father, to stand up to this final test as we are nearing the closing work of the gospel. We're asking the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit to be in the midst of us. We want to remember in our prayer those who are sick, to pour out your holy and mighty hand that they may feel that you are still God and the greatest physician ever had. We pray also those frontliners, especially the doctors, the nurses, to give them the courage and strength facing their jobs every day, taking care of all those sick at the hospitals. We remember also our leaders of the church, that they may continue to share the message of love and the soon coming of Jesus Christ. At this time, Father, we want to uphold to you our speaker that you sent unto us, our dear loving pastor, Trimayo Perdido. May you give him the heavenly wisdom as he shares your words. May it be a timely message to strengthen our faith in you while we are experiencing all these troubles in this world. Please open our hearts and our minds to understand your words through the guidance of your Holy Spirit. And may we live your words. Help us, Father, to get closer to you day by day and to become a torchbearer of your words to every individual, especially those who are still in darkness. We thank you, Father, for your love, your mercies, and your grace. We are asking now, Father, for the forgiveness of our sins, so that our worship this morning will be acceptable to the throne of grace. For we ask all this in the sweet name of Jesus. Amen.
Can God be bribed by our tithes and promises, regular and systematic offerings, even greetings, special protection, blessings, and answering prayers of those who faithfully give them to Him? Although the Bible teaches that unfaithfulness to God, tithes and offerings bring a curse, Malachi 3:8-10, it is also clear that He cannot bless those who give them while disregarding others' knowing aspect of His will. If regards iniquity in my heart, any iniquity, the Lord will not hear. Psalm 66:18 said David. Solomon also say that one who turns away his ears from hearing the law in his whole point, even his prayer is an abomination. Proverbs 28:9. God is not moved by religious exercise, including returning tithes and giving promise, while the givers harboring and haughty their heart, or his stubborn, breaking any other aspect of his will. Isaiah 1:11-15. But because the Bible said that all sinners, Romans 3:23, and deserve death, Romans 6:23, offerings and tithes accepted by God, and answer His Christ died to pay our sins, Romans 6:23, and to those who confess their sins, recognizing that they cannot change themselves, Jeremiah 13:23, He is faithfully and just to forgive us our sin and cleansing us for all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. Cleansing is a work of Holy Spirit that changes the heart. Ezekiel 36:23. And should predict any act of worship, it is important as forgiveness For without its forgiven sinners, would you like keep sinning again and again? Cleansing is also critical, that in the book of Malachi it's said that it's only after that experience that the offerings of Judea and Jerusalem will be pleasant to the Lord. Malachi 3:24. God accept Jesus' death on their behalf, confess their sins, and keep asking for the Holy Spirit to change their hearts. While you return your tithes and give your promises, today takes our time to confess our sins and to ask for a new purified heart. It is only when we confess our sin, placing them on the divine barrier, that our offerings can be pleased Him and be accepted by Him. Our tithes and offerings can be submitted online at AdventistGiving.ca. If you need help, feel free to contact any our deacons or deaconess. Let us pray. Lord, as we bring our tithes and offering, please accept the offerings of our whole heart. Take it, cleanse it, and heal it. Its unfaithfulness. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, boys and girls. Today's story is about Gideon's little army, a story of perseverance. After Joshua died, all the people of Israel disobeyed God and left him out of their lives. God let the neighboring Midianites burn Israel's crops and houses. One Israelite, Gideon, must have had a secret place to grow wheat. He threshed the grain by a hidden winepress under a large tree. The Midianites didn't know the place, but God did. God sent an angel with a message for Gideon. God wanted Gideon to destroy his own father's image of a false god and build an altar to the true God. Though Gideon was afraid his countrymen would kill him, he did what God commanded. God also wanted Gideon to lead Israel's army against the wicked Midianites, but Gideon was afraid. He asked for a special sign that God was with him. He laid a fleecy sheepskin on the ground. If there is dew on the fleece only, and it is dry on the ground, Gideon prayed, then I shall know that you will save Israel by my hand, as you have said. In the morning, the ground was dry, but the fleece was soaking wet. Gideon still doubted. Now he wanted God to send dew on the ground, but not on the fleece. The next morning, the ground was soggy, but the fleece was dry. Gideon started out with an army of 32,000. God cut it down to only 300 men. God did not want Israel to say, "My own hand has saved me." God alone was Israel's savior. Knowing Gideon was still afraid, God let him secretly overhear one Midianite soldier tell another about a strange dream. In the dream, a loaf of bread tumbled against a Midianite tent and destroyed it. The other guard was terrified. "This is the sword of Gideon," he cried. When Gideon heard the dream and its meaning, he knew God was going to give him the victory. Gideon planned a night attack. He gave each soldier a trumpet and empty pitchers with torches inside. They surrounded the Midianite army. At Gideon's signal, the soldiers blew their trumpets, smashed their pitchers, and lit their torches. "What noise! What confusion!" The scared Midianites got up and ran away. After this great victory, the men of Israel asked Gideon to rule over them. I will not rule over you. The Lord shall rule over you, Gideon replied. He knew that only God has the right to rule in people's lives. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death, but God loves us so much, He sent His Son, Jesus, to die on the cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live in Him forever. Today's memory verse comes from Romans 5, verse 3. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance. Let us close our eyes and bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day. Lord, I ask that you guide and help your young servants to believe and persevere in your name like Gideon. We thank you for the many blessings you have poured onto us and ask that you keep us safe during these troubled times. We ask you in Jesus' name, amen. Happy Sabbath, boys and girls.
Today, this task of introducing our guest speaker is a great privilege. He is happily married to Mrs. Nayolita Perdido. They were blessed with three children, Ranji, Diamond, and Rudolph Perdido, and three grandkids, Gabriel, Amber, and Elron Perdido. When asked about him, who he is may not be a surprise. After all, he had become the person he is now because of the virtues, values that was developed and nurtured in him during his education at Philippine Union College, Baeza Caloocan Campus in April 1976. He worked as intern district pastor and field secretary at Mountain Province Mission for 10 years and district pastor, department director, and executive secretary of Northern Luzon Mission for another 10 years. Although he was forced to retire on February 6, 1998 because of accident, he continued to work as translator of Philippines Ilocano Sabbath School lesson from 2000 until today. A man I personally admire because of his wisdom, generous heart, and caring spirit. Please welcome Pastor Tirimayo Molina Perdido.
Broken and spilled out. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. For he is faithful that promised. Hebrews 10, verse 23. With Canada's most internationally recognized attraction of Niagara Falls that is straddled the international border between Ontario and the U.S. state of New York, and an unstoppable water flow of about more than 2,800,000 liters per second that roar over the edge of Horseshoe Falls and plummets to a violent pool about 57 meters below. And the most multiculturally diverse city on the planet, with over 140 languages that are spoken in Toronto, the vibrant, world-class urban center of Ontario, with the CN Tower as one of Canada's most iconic structures in Toronto skyline, with its 553-meter tower that gives a astounding look over the city and Lake Ontario. Ottawa, an active capital of Canada, which is on the bank of Ottawa River and the seventh coldest capital in the world, and a cultural hub where the Peace Tower in Parliament Hill and its tower that is more than 90 meters high between the Senate and the House of Commons. The Algonquin Provincial Park, Ontario's oldest park of thick pine forest, jagged cliffs, trickling crystal streams, and home to an essentially Canadian ecosystem of bears, brook trout, moose, wolves, a haven for canoeists and hikers that offers the chance to explore into nature's breathtaking beauty that offers a pristine expanse of wilderness. The caves with their twisting complex of tunnels and eerily stunning tunnels of stalactites and tons of prehistoric fossils and park system considered to be one of the best kayaking destinations in the world, where you enjoy the azure waters along the shores. All these beautifully created wonders of our God has given for us inspires me to greet all God's children in Filipino-Canadian Seventh-day Adventist Church members in their respective dwelling places. A pleasant morning and a blessed Sabbath day. Let us pray. Loving Father in heaven, we come to you in Jesus, seeking the blessing, seeking your favor. Without Christ, no one could find your favor. And so, in his name and for his sake, dear God, we ask you to bless us. If we have offended you, forgive us, dear Father, and grant to us the Spirit of truth, that he may guide us into truth and give us a heart to receive, accept, and obey your words. Bless everyone in their respective dwellings as they listen to your words now, and I pray, possess my mind. Use me as an unresisting instrument on your hand as we study in the church theme, Perseverance. In Jesus' worthy name, amen. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. I have often wondered what was the difference between people who give in and give up and those who reach their personal goals and go far beyond the expectations of the world. While the definition of success may be relative and mean different things for different people, there are habitual patterns in people that give clues to how their life will eventually turn out, regardless of what they pursue. Have you seen these patterns before? Threads of incompletion in a majority of projects, a lack of definite purpose and a sense of direction, evasive techniques such as a lot of complaining, blame, and bitterness, scathing criticism of things even before they are allowed to bloom, habits that do not support success, a lack of commitment and responsibility towards major goals, inability to focus on something for better than a few months, giving up under the burden of setbacks and difficulties. Now, we may have all had some or all of the above at some times of our lives or another, and I certainly do not present the least to judge or criticize our weaknesses. Perseverance does not also mean to spin your wheels when something just does not work out. You may have to do something different and take a new approach if things are continually resistant to working out. However, it is my intention to shine the light of awareness on some of the patterns and the lack of perseverance that wreaks havoc in our lives. Hopefully, we can all put to rest some of those patterns in the lack of perseverance in our lives. Whether it is that next creative project or something that you would love to complete, here are a few suggestions to supercharge our power of perseverance. Let us begin. the amazing power of yes. While you do not have to be a habitual yes person, are you saying no to all the great opportunities and the potential hope and relief in your life? What dominates your attention in your life? A deep sense of negativity and cynicism, or an implicit understanding of hope and possibility? Psychology research has shown repeatedly the power and efficacy of negativity and the negativity bias that our brains are seemingly wired towards. If your brain is doling out the negativity to you, stop listening and begin by replacing with thoughts and feelings that facilitate perseverance and not destroy it. When we start to feel distant from God or feel like we've lost our way, God is still there. He waits for us to return and offers forgiveness and grace. Out of his presence is anxiety and fear, but in him there is abundant life, purpose, and joy. Ask God's forgiveness for what you need to make right with him. Thank him for covering of care, for his use, mercy, and love. Pray for wisdom and stay close to him, believing there is protection and goodness there. In the space between yes and no, there is a lifetime. It's the difference between the path you walk and one you leave behind. It's the gap between who you thought you could be and who you really are, said Jody Picoult. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Believe that something is impossible to do and to complete. Do you have a very deep and irrevocable idea that things are just quite impossible to accomplish and great success is only for others? Time to lay that belief to rest for good. Every great person, including great characters in Bible, knew that what they were up against was seemingly impossible. However, they did not dwell their attention on how it was impossible and could not be done. Instead, they went on towards their greatest aspirations and dreams till the sun broke through the clouds of despair and the light shone its way inside. Do you have an "it is impossible" attitude towards your goals and desires? Become aware that impossibility mindsets destroys and reverses any sign of perseverance before it can take flight. Resentment toward others or even toward ourselves can be controlling and consuming. It can breed bitterness and anxiety. Don't let it win. Pray that God will help you to let go of where you have been wrong, even when it's hard. Choosing to forgive, determined to walk in love, knowing that his grace and forgiveness covers all. Pray that God will help you to release every past mistake to him and walk in the freedom and peace he brings. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Do you stay with your problems? This is unquestionably one secret that all highly creative and successful people share with each other. They allow the single-minded pursuit of the skill that they want to master. They then practice at the edge of their comfort level by slowly but surely honoring their skills. They practice every sequence, every stroke, every note till they have acquired mastery in their realm. Perseverance is the key to success. After thousands of efforts to make the electric light bulb, Thomas Edison said, "I haven't failed. I've identified 10,000 ways that it doesn't work." Helen Keller, Abraham Lincoln, Marie Curie, and an endless list of other great achievers found that success inevitably arrives for everyone who perseveres. However, there may be no great people who did not put in a lot of work and persevere till they became fluid and masterful in their arts. Remember to hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. The role of anxiety in perseverance. This is by far the most important element of continuous perseverance. It is as if we have been wired with the famous flight and fight response when things go too badly or even if they go too well. And we freak out when things go very wrong or if we become successful beyond our wildest dreams. We suffer from the upper limit problem or confining our genius and happiness within preset limits. Perseverance and the perceived lack of results is enough to set in a deep level of anxiety that things are not working. Alternatively, if things do work out, the change itself is enough to provoke an anxiety deep enough to rethink the act of persevering. If you are not used to persevere beyond a certain length, the passion, the strong feelings, and the continuity might just make you feel very unsettled, and the discomfort experience may beg you to quit. But when you feel discomfort of being in a completely new territory of practice with your skills, you need to still go beyond that barrier. There is no limit to the extent and limit the fluidity and flow that you can achieve, for we hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. The experience of coming out at the other end. One of the major reasons to stick with something despite all the odds is the experience that you will gather in the process. Often, you may make the rationalization that something is not of great value to you, but in reality, you are learning invaluable skills if you stick with it. In hindsight, things and skills that do not beg the attention of your perseverance and completion may prove to be very valuable. Taking very small steps is better than taking no steps. Often people think that change should happen in huge leaps and measurable change. While this happens sometimes, you should not feel discouraged by the apparent lack of progress. One of the biggest threats to perseverance is the lack of results and the subsequent quitting while it is still too soon to see any results. A better option is to take very small steps and keep it instead of taking a giant leap and then quitting. You also risk the potential of burnout if you go all out and then quickly lose interest. You may need to dive deep into the core of why you are doing something and keep that intention steadfast in your attention. In other words, small steps are highly effective and perhaps the best way to maintain perseverance over long periods of time. Confucius said, "The man who moves a mountain begins by carrying away small stones." And the inspired word says, "Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering." Face those fears and affirm those commitments. There is nothing that sparks the fear process faster than a commitment to a long-term project in some people. The problem with those long-term fears is that they appear in your next project and then the next. It is almost that they get emboldened by a lack of perseverance. However, The converse is also true. Once you allow the fears to be there and act in spite of them, you demonstrate to yourself that you have the ability to transcend fears in any setting. Fear to persevere is a very common fear, and the sooner you acknowledge it, take a deep breath, and begin moving along, the better it is for your goals. Our brains make sense of the world, though self-evidence and true social proof. Even completions become habitual, it becomes very difficult to believe and convince your deep inner self and your conscious brain that you have what it takes to complete something. The solution is to complete any incompletions in your life or to finally allow them to be released from your consciousness. So, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Make failure and setbacks your best friends and teachers. The most difficult experience that you might come up against in your journey of perseverance is the idea of setbacks and failures and how to manage them. Everyone wants to succeed quickly, but failure is interwoven in the story of success and perseverance. Failure teaches you how to adjust your sails to navigate the seas of uncertainty and do things differently. If you change the meaning that you assign failure and setbacks, you will have much better success in perseverance. If you take failure and use it to your advantage, you can persevere the change of seasons without losing hope. Really, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. What about will and determination? Motivation research has shown us that willpower is exhaustible and we only possess a specific amount till it runs out and needs recharging. However, the willpower that exhausts is the day-to-day kind that you will have to replenish through sleep and rest. There is a greater will or determination that arises out of intrinsic motivation and a deep sense of connectedness to a great purpose that shines through unsuccessful moments and propels people forward. It is this self-determination, the idea that what you are pursuing is really worth it, that fuels success. It is this long-term willpower and determination that allows you to pursue and persevere all situations. To connect to this deep place of will, you will have to determine the underlying reasons why you want to do something and why you want to persevere. When you connect your goals to a higher purpose and something that invokes strong feelings of awe and wonder in you, you have a better chance at perseverance. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "If you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. Do not make quitting a habit. Defeat whispers into your ears frequently, but if you have determined to follow the course and stay the length, pay no heed to it because its sounds only betray your deepest wishes. The most important lessons you may learn on the path of perseverance is that the chances to quit will be plenty and the roads will diverge many times. The choice is yours to make if your power of perseverance is greater than the sum of relief that defeat will provide. Many times, staying the course is uncomfortable and scary and uncertain, and you will want to quit. Always remember that no matter what happens, you should continue forward. Even if it means taking a rest and repurposing your plan, you need to move forward. Every success and journey of perseverance becomes a habit. Every act of quitting takes you closer to making it a habit of quitting. So let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Even the worst shall pass. Even though we all know this, it does not seem that way when you are in the middle of the storm. Your world turns upside down, and all you think of is a way out, an escape. Take a deep breath and settle in the understanding and awareness that nothing lasts forever. How would your life look like in a year, in 5 years, and in 10 years? Would you still be concerned with the temporary storms that you are facing at the moment? How would you feel if you gave a long-term plan and dreamed for temporary storms that will pass? Helen Keller said, "A bend in the road is not the end of the road unless you fail to make the turn." Set up structures and make perseverance consistent and habitual. This is a very important question to ask yourself. You want to write, but do not carve any writing time out. You want to work on a new business idea, but you are too caught up with what is on television. Do your habits and structures support the idea that you want to persevere in your projects? Do you consistently take habitual actions that allow you to persevere in the first place? It is a case of misplaced attention when you criticize yourself of lack of determination or perseverance when you have not cultivated any habits that allow you to stay in the course of faith. Change is hardest at the beginning, messiest in the middle, and best at the end, says Robin S. Sharma. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Perseverance needs extraordinary courage. Perseverance is a true act of courage. Staying the course in the face of uncertain outcomes is a leap of faith and an act of belief that requires exceptional courage. Courage also does not mean that you rush into crisis, but may also mean the little voice of reason that allows you to continue day after day, making adjustments and moving forward. Courage doesn't always roar. Sometimes courage is the little voice at the end of the day that says, "I'll try again tomorrow," Mary Ann Redmacher said. So let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Gather some social proof. On the journey of perseverance, it may be highly beneficial to provide yourself social proof along the way. Even though what you might be attempting might be noble, there have been people like you who have attempted similar things and perhaps even more adversity. Giving yourself the social proof that it can be done keeps you inspired when the going gets tough. Doing everything all by yourself and not seeking social assistance is very difficult, especially in the long haul, and you might just feel isolated enough and give up. If you are not connecting and seeking assistance, you need to ask yourself what issues you have with asking others for direction and involving them in your plans. However, be cautioned that do not seek the counsel of the first person who decides to listen to you, because it is very easy to get carried away in other people's anxieties and criticisms. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith. Having faith and a great attitude. In order to persevere, you need to develop a deep and unflinching sense of hope, faith, and belief in your abilities and the idea that you will succeed and persevere. It is this belief, when on a shaky foundation, that makes people give up and give in, even though they might be close to victory. If you can develop an attitude of overwhelming optimism and hope regardless of the course of the journey, you have a much better chance at perseverance. If you develop a great spirited attitude that emanates from within you and not just a front or facade, you have already half won the perseverance battle. The doing of something productive, regardless of the outcome, is an act of faith. The doing of a small something when a large something is too much for us is perhaps especially an act of faith. Faith means going forward by whatever means we can, says Julia Cameron. Stay fast, the profession of our faith, without wavering. Do you think that talent is more important? You may have been programmed to believe that talent and genius are more important than staying the course. However, deeply intertwined in every story of personal talent and genius is the thread of perseverance and determination. Without perseverance, genius is lost and talent is easily wasted. Have you seen stories of people who thought would conquer mountains because of their intellect and their boundless talents? Have you not been astonished to find that after decades, it was not them, the talented ones, but the ones that work hard and had little talent that rose to heights that were enviable? I do not think that there is any other quality so essential to success of any kind as the quality of perseverance. It overcomes almost everything, even nature, said John D. Rockefeller. Continually apply what you learn. And finally, to make your journey of perseverance interesting and relevant, continually apply what you learn along the way. This makes the journey very rich and transforms it into an adventure. This adventure of perseverance will light up your life and your path and show the way to countless others who will strive to follow your example. To live is not to learn, but to apply, says Legault. Jesus said, "Come and follow me." In Matthew 19:21, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. When the odds seem stuck against us and we're face to face with big obstacles, it can feel insurmountable. But often, this is the very place where God shows up strong on our behalf. He sees victory. When we see the defeat, pray that he will do what seems impossible on your behalf, that he would help you to stand strong in wisdom and faith, believing his word that no weapon formed against us will prosper. And so, to the leadership and officers of the Filipino-Canadian Church and church members who, in one way or the other, made this privilege possible for me to be a servant of our Savior in sharing this message to his people, I express and convey from the bottom of my heart my heartfelt thanks, and may we continue holding fast the profession of our faith without wavering, that our faithful God can fulfill his promise to all of us, life eternal, and be with him in his eternal kingdom forever. Happy Sabbath to all. May God bless each one of us. Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, problems, worry, and stress have an incredible way of stealing our joy. We pray that God will renew our mind in him, that His joy would fill our heart and be our strength today. We thank Him that true joy and peace are never dependent on our external circumstances, but are found in Him alone. So, dear God, grant us hope and faith and love. Hope for a world grown cynically cold, hungry for power and greedy for gold. Faith to believe when within and without there's a nameless fear in a world of doubt. Love that is bigger than race or creed, to cover the world and fulfill its need. God, grant these gifts of faith, hope, and love. Three things this world has so little of. For only in these gifts from our Father above can turn men's sins from hatred to love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our closing song, When We All Get to Heaven, hymn number 495.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus.
The love of God, the grace of the Son, and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit be upon you all. Amen.
Christ alone imparts faith in the promise.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us in our worship this morning. A special thanks to our Ilocano group for serving us today, especially our guest speaker, Pastor Perdido. Thank you so much for delivering God's message for all of us this morning, for the very encouraging words that you have shared with us today. Thank you so much. And also want to thank Chriselle Calixtro for putting the video together for us today. And of course, Kiamani, thank you so much again to everyone. Happy Sabbath, and please join us again next week, same time, 11 a.m. and for our live stream. Thank you, and happy Sabbath to everyone. God bless all of you. Thank you so much.